This is the Bible Line, a live radio call-in program with Dr. Carl Brogy. Dr. Brogy is the senior pastor of Community Bible Church of Beaufort, South Carolina. And for the next hour, he's available to answer your questions, providing biblical insight and wisdom for everyday Christian living. Our phone lines are open, and if you have a question, you may call 525-1859 locally, or outside the immediate area, call toll-free 877-924-7980. Now let's join Dr. Carl Brogy.
Study and show yourself approved of God as a workman who is not ashamed, accurately, rightly dividing the word of truth. I welcome you this hour to the Bible Line and to our first-time listeners, a special welcome. For the next hour, we will be taking people's questions. Maybe there's a theological conundrum or some issue you're facing in your personal life or ministry or family, and you're trying to understand a passage and maybe how to apply it or what to apply and where to find it. If we can be of help, by God's grace, we'll do our best. Again, there are several ways that you can contact us. The local 843 exchange is simply 525-1859. When you go on the air, you can dictate your question, or when you call live, or you can go on the air. So we give you that choice, whatever you're comfortable doing. And again, there's another way in which you can contact us, and that's at the Bible Line. That stands for TBL, the Bible Line, TBL at WAGP.net. So those are several ways in which to contact us. And let's go ahead, Walter, and we'll get started this morning.
All right. Good morning, Pastor Carl. Our first question comes from Gloria out of Beaufort, South Carolina, and she writes, both Matthew and Luke spend a huge amount of time on Jesus' genealogy. Can you explain what you think God wants us to know, understanding that Jesus is traced back to Genesis and the promise of a Savior who would be the seed of the woman and Savior?
Well, it's a great question. I preached a sermon on this one time in a Christmas message. But Matthew, his genealogy, of course, starts with Abraham, and it goes all the way through David. And as you read it, it appears, you know, people sometimes who are Jewish and they read Matthew 1, they say, this sounds like a Jewish book, and it is. The record of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And then he starts, Abraham was the father of Isaac and so forth. And then, you know, he brings it all the way down to Jacob was the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, by whom, that is, it's feminine going back to Mary, Jesus was born, who is called the Messiah. And so Matthew is demonstrating that Jesus has a legal right to the throne, that he is the promised one. And so that's the focus of his gospel, that Jesus is indeed Israel's king, that he is the son of David, the son of Abraham. By contrast, you go to Luke's genealogy in the third chapter, and he starts with Jesus, and he goes all the way back to Adam. And he's demonstrating that Jesus is the son of God. So there are three great titles that are given to the Lord. He's the son of David, he's the son of God, and he's the son of man. And the focus of Luke is on his deity being the Son of God. Not that Matthew, of course, denies that. He will affirm that as well. So Matthew's focus is a Jewish audience, whereas Luke's focus is a Gentile audience. Why does he give us these two genealogies? Well, I think a couple of reasons, really many reasons. But when you come to verse 11, and this was one of my messages some years back, it says, Josiah became the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. Now, a Jew who knew his Old Testament, that would jump out at him because he would immediately think, no, wait a minute. Jeconiah, who's also called Coniah or Jehoiachin in the Bible, he was a very evil king. And if you read Jeremiah's account, Jeremiah 22, Jeremiah writes during the time of the Babylonian deportation, and he reminds the readers that Jeconiah, or Jehoiachin, is cursed. He would be childless. And childless, of course, in the context is politically speaking. That is, and again, the terms find their meaning in context. And so Jehoiachin would be childless. That is, there would be no leader from his loins who would sit on Israel's throne. And so what Matthew does is really profound in that he underscores right off that in the legal lineage from Abraham to Jesus, that Jesus has a legal right to the throne. And yet, wait a minute, no one from Jeconiah's lineage can sit on the throne. And so the need for the virgin conception. And so when you read the rest of the chapter, he's underscoring that indeed Mary would be within her womb, there would be a virgin conception. And interestingly, when you go to Luke's genealogy, he traces the lineage. At one point, there's a switch, and he traces it through through Mary. And so on the one hand, Joseph, he is indeed a legal heir to the throne. On the other hand, since he's a descendant of Jeconiah, he can't serve on the throne. And so yet the Messiah, indeed, the Lord Jesus, is from the family of David, and so he has a legal right to the throne. So one is underscoring the legality, the other the biology, and so the need for a virgin conception, since no one could come from Jeconiah's loins all the way down to Joseph. And so Joseph is not the father. And so it's interesting when that last verse I just read, it says, it says Jacob was the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, by whom? Now, Mary is a feminine word, and in Greek, words have to agree in number and gender. So the by whom does not go back to Joseph. It's a feminine pronoun. It modifies Mary. So it's by whom, namely Mary, that Jesus was born and so-called the Messiah. So there's no filler in Scripture. People think this is a waste, but it's not. It's a powerful refutation to those who would argue away the virgin birth, or those who would argue away its necessity, or those who would say that Jesus had no legal right to the throne. Great question. Let's go on to the next.
All right, 843-525-1859. Again, that is 843-525-1859. If you have a question for Pastor Carl this morning, we're going to go to the phone lines, Pastor Carl. We have John Wade from Ridgeland, South Carolina. Good morning, John Wade. What is your question?
Good morning, Pastor Carl and Walter. Just had a question, I guess somewhat concerning the pastor from Dallas that had the inappropriate relationship with a female. I'm not really going to call his name. You can if you want to. But so I was reading on X last night, another pastor that I respect posted this thing about the situation, and the website is reformation21.org. And I'm just going to read this sentence or two because I'm kind of confused about, I guess, my understanding of the five-point Calvinist and Reformation teaching. So it says, we should be somewhat cautious about emphasizing the devil's work here as if to make it sound like this pastor was the victim. Let's be clear, what this pastor has done has been of his own free will, even if there were external causes. And so I guess my question is, can you help me understand what the staunch five-point Calvinist reformed theologians are teaching? I didn't think they believed in free will. I thought everything was predestined and,
right.
controlled.
Well, it's a good question. So sadly, this pastor, you know, fell as an act of his own free will. He can't blame anyone but himself. He made a series of decisions in his life that really made him susceptible to where he was at. You know, marriages don't suffer from a blowout. They suffer from a slow leak. And the same could be said in most realms of temptation. You know, it's not like one day all of a sudden you're going to commit adultery. No, there's a process that leads up to it. And I don't know all the details, and I suspect the story will come out at some point. But I think there's a lot more to it, and it probably goes back further than you think. With that said, Reformation theology is, basically affirming that, it's much more than just the five points of Calvinism. Reformation theology is a whole system of theology that affects not only soteriology. Soto is the word means to save, and so soteriology is the doctrine of salvation. And they certainly affirm five points, but their theology goes much broader. It affects their eschatology, their study of last things. It affects their ecclesiology, their study of the church. And so there are some people who have aspects of Reformed theology, maybe in their doctrine of salvation, but not necessarily in their doctrine of the church. And so he was kind of a combo guy in the sense that he believed there was a future for Israel. Most Reformed theologians don't. So the term Reformed theology typically highlights not only the 5 points of Calvinism, though John Calvin himself, I think, was a four-pointer, but it also highlights a certain view concerning Israel. And so the word has been robbed. It's like the word charismatic. If someone asked me, am I a charismatic, I'd say, well, it depends what you mean by it. If you mean I'm a charismatic in that I should, you know, fall on the floor, be slain in the spirit, charm snakes, speak in tongues like some groups do in whole or in part, I'd say no. But if you're asking me, do I believe at least 16 of the 20 spiritual gifts listed in the New Testament are still given, I'd say yes, and someone should find out at least what their gift or gifts might be so that they can use and exercise them in serving the body of Christ. Well, the word reformation or reformed has been robbed, and now it typically sticks to those who are five-point Calvinists, where historically the the Reformation highlighted five pillars, the five pillars that are on the stained glass window behind me that I preach every Sunday morning, that we're saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, based on the Bible alone, Scripture alone, to the glory of God alone. Those are the pillars of the Reformation. And so there was a time historically where if you affirm those, you would be one who was embracing Reformed theology. In terms of the doctrine of salvation, TULIP, total depravity, U, unconditional election, L, limited atonement, Jesus didn't die for all but for a select few, I, irresistible grace, and P, perseverance of the saints. And even those terms are defined differently within particular groups of those who are in Reformed theology. So in fairness to the Reformed theologian, he is not denying free will. He is just saying that free will is limited. In fact, the Reformed theologian believes that there are, and again, I'm using it in terms of the modern day usage groups like Reformation 21, believes that some people from birth are incapable of being saved. They are incapable of being saved. I don't believe that for one skinny moment. I believe anyone can be saved. Now, do I believe that man is depraved? Yes. So with that said, I think God has to be the first mover. It's not Adam who comes running back to God, Lord, I'm so sorry for what I've done. Please forgive me. No, there's none who seeks God, no, not one, as Paul reminds us, quoting the Old Testament in Romans 3. So God comes after Adam. Where are you, Adam? That's God seeking after man, not asking a question to learn. God is omniscient, obviously, but only to reveal, and he is revealing there's a problem. So they don't deny free will, but they would say that a man's free will as it relates to salvation is predisposed to God's sovereign will first. And I would say that's a half-truth. I would say it in the sense that God's Spirit works on all men. When it says when he, the Spirit, comes, he'll convict the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. I think world means world. And I think God gives all men some form of revelation, and if they respond to the most general of revelation, God gives specific revelation so that men might hear the gospel and respond and believe. Not all people do. Why? Because they choose not to. They choose not to believe. And so, again, they would just say, yes, as an act of my own free will, I said yes to Christ, but only because God said first yes to me. And I would say, well, that's a half-truth, and that God says in one sense yes to all when he says he desires all to be saved and none to perish, when he desires all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of truth, and he desires all men to repent. He means all. It's not a collective all. It's all. All means all. There are collective alls in Scripture, but in the context of 1 Timothy 2 or in Peter's epistle, it's not a collective all, clearly. So no one in the Reformed camp is denying, in the process of sanctification, that there are choices that we must make once we are saved. The free will emphasis is largely on the front end justification, but not in the in-between tense of salvation, sanctification. they would say there's a series of decisions that we have to make in order to grow. Now, there are some hyper Calvinists who, you know, would say that that's not true, that God does everything. And I think that's silly. It's stupid. It goes against the tenor of Scripture. And if someone says that that's the average person in Reformed theology, then they've created a straw man that they are tearing down. It's easy to create straw men and then tear them down. We need to create iron men. What do they actually teach? And not to find some weird exceptions. It's like dispensationalism. People find these, you know, these extreme dispensationalists and one guy who taught something and nobody else basically believed it. And they say, this is what dispensationalists in general believe. Or they attack the rapture and they say there's a lady, Margaret MacDonald, who had this wacko dream and she gave it to another brother and he came up with the rapture. I mean, that's not even close to being accurate. It's just stupid. It's imbecilic. It's not even right. But it's easy to create these straw men. So no one in the Reform camp, in fairness to them, would say that this pastor in Dallas did something apart from his own free will. He freely chose. And again, it usually comes out, there was a series of choices that he made along the way. And any of us could make that. And that's why we need to guard our own hearts. Let him who thinks he stands be careful lest he fall. Because it starts slowly. It starts subtly. Someone is comfortable watching a TV show with a little bit of sensuality in it. They're breaking their spirit down. They're willing to listen to some music with sensuality in it. They're breaking their spirit down. They're willing to linger at an internet site with a little sensuality in it. They're breaking their spirit down. And when they do that, they weaken themselves and they set themselves up for a greater fall down the road. Fair question. Let's go on to the next.
843-525-1859 if you have a question for Pastor Carl on this morning's Bible Line. Our next question comes from M.L. Stillman, and he writes, there was a man who came to America named Dimitri Duduman from Romania, and he said that God sent him here to share a vision that America will burn, referencing a nuclear war with Russia and China due to all the sin and wickedness, especially from the LGBTQ plus agenda. Have you heard of this?
Well, I haven't heard his name in a long time. I became a Christian in 1975, and he was a Romanian pastor who came to America. And he had an influence on, at least in the Pentecostal realms, in the American church in the 1990s. And basically he would say, well, God gave me this vision, God gave me this dream, and he would, with authority, say, this is what's going to happen. And I would caution anyone who still follows him, I don't know if anyone does, he's been dead since the late 90s, if I remember, and he died relatively young in his early 60s. What it brought me to was Deuteronomy 18, and it says this, but the prophet who speaks a word presumptuously in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or which he speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die. You may say in your heart, how will we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the thing does not come about or come true, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken, the prophet has spoken it presumptuously, you shall be afraid of him. And so God warns if some guy comes along with some vision or dream, and in my perspective, the canon of Scripture is closed. There was a time when God spoke directly through dreams and visions. That's not to say that God couldn't give a dream today, but if he gave a dream to bring someone to Christ, it wouldn't contradict, either add or subtract to the revelation that God has already given in Holy Scripture. So the canon is closed. And for someone to have a dream and to say, this is going to happen, or this is what God showed me, and it's in contradiction to Scripture, or it adds to Scripture, that's what we call a false prophet. So you have a Joseph Smith who has, you know, an extra revelation. You have a Mary Baker Eddy who has a founder of Christian Science, Joseph Smith, Mormonism, of course. She has an extra revelation, a vision. You have Ellen G. White, the founder of Seventh-day Adventism. Almost every cult is built on some dream, some vision, something plus and beyond the Scripture itself. And so he made a number of predictions, largely during the time when the Cold War was very intense, saying that Russia was going to attack America with missiles because of America's disobedience and rebelliousness, and they're embracing homosexuality. And, well, certainly it's wrong that our country was embracing homosexuality in the 90s, and that's where it really began to kick into a new level. You had someone for the first time, Ellen DeGeneres, I call her, you know, kissing another female on national TV, and they're opening the door. And so he made these predictions, none of which came true. These American cities were going to be destroyed, and none of it came true, and he dated some of them. So sadly, those who studied end times, and they thought, oh, this is interesting, and that's what sells, sensationalism. But listen, you should stick to the Bible, not to sensationalism. You should stick to what God has revealed, not to some extra biblical revelation. And so this man from Romania was just in gross error. I don't know what else to say. I'm not going to say he was lost. I'm not his judge, but I can say that what he did was displeasing to the Lord because it was in direct contradiction to Scripture. Good question. Where did that question come from?
ML Stillman, Pastor Carl.
All right, whoever that is or wherever she's from, but go ahead. All right. Let's go to the next one.
Yes, sir. Our next question comes from Sonya out of Rincon, Georgia, and she writes, in Revelation chapter 9, verse 4, the locusts coming up out of the abyss were told not to harm the grass of the earth. But wasn't all of the green grass already burned up by the hail and fire mixed blood in Revelation 8, verse 7, in the first trumpet blast? Also, in Revelation chapter 16, verse 12, the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the Euphrates to dry it up to make way for the kings from the east. Hadn't the third bowl judgment in Revelation chapter 16, verse 4, turned all of the springs and rivers into blood? Therefore, why was there still water in the Euphrates during the sixth bowl judgment? I know that there are explanations for all of this, as there are no contradictions in the Bible. I just want to understand how to keep it straight in my mind. Thank you.
Well, let me just give some context in terms of the coming seven-year period. It's called the time of tribulation, the time of Jacob's trouble. It's divided into two halves, the first half 3.5 years long, where there's a world religion, there is a world leader. He's called by 30-some titles. Maybe the most popular title is Antichrist, so John alone uses it in one of his letters. Beyond that, his focus is to make a peace treaty, so to speak, a covenant with Israel, which kicks in this seven-year period. Not the rapture. It happens after the rapture, probably a very short time after the rapture, when the world is in chaos. But this seven-year period begins, and in the first half of the tribulation, he seemingly protects Israel, but eventually he turns on Israel because he's anti-Messiah. And he hates the Jews. Satan has always hated the Jews, always has wanted to destroy the Jews, whether it's through a pharaoh who wants the Jewish little boys to be murdered, whether it's through a Haman in the time of Esther, whether it's through a Hitler. He has always hated the Jews. And as we move to the end of the age, the Bible predicts that Jewish hatred would grow and deepen and broaden. So one of the functions of this seven-year period is to bring one Israel to repentance, for them to acknowledge that Jesus is the Messiah. There's always been a remnant of believing Jews, but most Jews today are in unbelief. That's going to change in the future. In fact, they're going to lead the way in sharing the gospel during this seven-year period. So what will God use? He uses a series of 21 judgments. They come in the form of seals, trumpets, and bowls. There are seven seals, and the seventh seal is contained seven trumpets. And the seventh trumpet is contained seven bowls of wrath. So I've turned here to Revelation 4 to answer your question. Revelation 9, excuse me, or Revelation, let me start in Revelation 8 here, verse 4. The first sounded, and there came hail and fire mixed with blood, and they were thrown to the earth. And a third of the earth was burned up, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. So this first trumpet that is sounded, remember in the seventh seal is contained seven trumpets, it brings judgment on the vegetation that grows on the earth. In the first half of the tribulation, there's still plenty of green trees and green grass. which implies that rainfall is normal and life to some degree is normal in terms of water cycles, but this is going to change it. And let me say, this is literal. You get some people who get really dramatic and they say, well, this is a nuclear bomb and it's going to destroy the vegetation on the earth in sections. And again, that's sensationalism. That sells. But the text is very clear here. This is not some man-made disaster. All of these come from heaven. It says there came hail and fire thrown to the earth. So it's from heaven. That's the source. And like the judgments that come upon Egypt, these are literal, actual judgments. And so what we read here is kind of interesting because here's the point is you say, well, how does she ask it specifically in 9:4, the locusts coming up, out of the abyss? Read it to me. I can't see it. The
it says
screen from
in,
here.
In Revelation 9, chapter verse 4, the locusts coming out of the abyss were told not to harm the grass of the earth, but wasn't all of the green grass already burnt up by the hail and fire mixed with blood? And as it references
okay,
Revelation
got it,
chapter
got
8.
It. So in the first trumpet, we just read about what was destroyed, and now you have the fifth trumpet. So there's some space between these trumpets, and undoubtedly there was some time that allowed the grass to come back. You know, I skinned my grass last week, and there's already new grass that has sprouted in its place. It doesn't take long, especially if there's a little bit of moisture in the soil. It takes virtually no time at all. There was a time in New England where every spring we would burn our lawns. I don't know if people do that anymore for ecological purposes, but you'd go out and you'd burn your lawn in the spring, and it would look all black, but it made for green grass to sprout up within a week. And so some time has transpired, and so now there is an opportunity again for the plant life to be attacked. So it's not rocket science. It's just recognizing there's some times. Now, what's the second half of the question? Read it to me.
The second half states, hadn't the third bowl judgment in Revelation chapter 16, verse 4, turned all of the springs and rivers into blood? Therefore, why was there still water in the Euphrates during the sixth bowl judgment?
Okay, so let me turn there, and it says when we read of the third bowl, it says, then the third angel, again, there are angels associated with all these judgments. They're here to execute God's judgment on the earth. He poured out his bowl into the rivers and the springs, and they became blood. So fresh water becomes blood. Now, remember, the bowl judgments come right at the end. There's not much time left when the bowl judgments come. The very nature of the bowl judgments indicate that. When you see the severity of the judgments, I mean, think about what's happened up till now. If you hold up four fingers in front of your face right now, in the seal judgments, one-third of the population dies. So you've got three fingers left. When you come to the trumpet judgments, in the seal judgments, one-fourth of the population dies, so you have three fingers left. In the trumpet judgments, one-third of the earth dies. So you've got three fingers, take down one. By the time the trumpet judgments are over, half the planet is dead. By the way, you can't spiritualize this and say, well, this was the judgment that Titus Vespucian brought on Jerusalem in 70 AD. There's nothing like this in all of human time. But that's, by the way, what the Calvinist does, the amillennialist, in his eschatology. He allegorizes these passages of Scripture to answer an earlier question in terms of how Calvinism affects the realm of eschatology. So you've got half the planet dead by the time the bowl judgments come. The sealed judgments come in the first half of the tribulation. We know that because Matthew 24 perfectly parallels the sealed judgments. And then there's a middle event that happens dead center. Daniel tells us, Jesus tells us, when the Antichrist goes in the temple and confesses to be God in human flesh. And of course, then it goes from a world religion where all the religions are recognized to an exclusive religion where you must worship him. That brings the trumpet judgments. And by the way, when that happens, the Bible says there's 30 minutes of silence in heaven. You see, with the seal judgments, you can only see one seal at a time. But when the seventh seal is broken, you can see all seven trumpet judgments. And in the seventh trumpet, you can see all seven bowl judgments. And it's like people's breath is taken away. There's 30 minutes of silence in heaven because they know what is in front is beyond belief. And so in the first bowl, you read of these sores that come. In the second bowl, how the rivers are contaminated. And then you read in this third bowl, I'm reading here, then the third angel poured out his bowl into the rivers and the springs of water. They became like blood, literal blood. And so you can't drink blood. It's going to make you sick. People will do it anyway. But then there's another bowl that comes, a fourth bowl, where the population is scorched. There's something that happens in the realm of the sun. What's that going to do? Well, that's going to create a massive snow melt. And the Euphrates River, by the way, is fed by Mount Ararat. And I covered this in my sermon on the Revelation. And so the sixth angel poured out his bowl in the great river, the Euphrates, and its water was dried up. So the water in some respects have been restored. It's probably a light blood water, but it's drinkable without killing you because God's not done with the population yet. But then he brings a scorching sun that melts all of the ice caps across the planet. The rivers and the like are refurbished. And so God sends this sixth angel, and he pours out his bowl in the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up so that the way would be prepared for the kings of the east. And so think about it. When there's this scorching bowl in the fourth bowl, there's no doubt a washout. My brother lives in Vermont, and they've, over the last 3 years, have had a number of just torrential rains, and entire roads have been washed out. Rivers have so swelled that bridges are gone, and they're still building from the most recent one a couple months ago. I mean, it's a disaster. Well, this is going to be a worldwide disaster. And so the typical means of transportation to get there to Israel is going to be removed. And so there's this mighty river Euphrates that becomes like a highway where the kings of the east march up. Where are they going? They're going to Israel. They're going to the valley of the Jezreel Valley. We call it the Valley of Armageddon in Christianese sometimes, though there's technically no valley named that. But the Jezreel Valley is the launching place in which all the nations of the world will come to go against Jerusalem, to fight against Israel in fulfillment of prophecy. So these things will literally happen. I would recommend, Sonya, maybe get the Search the Scriptures app and start listening to Revelation. There's 72 hours of teaching on it, and I go through every single verse in Revelation. Maybe that would answer some more of your questions. Let's go to the next question. I spent a lot of time on that, but let's go to the next one.
843-525-1859. Again, that is 843-525-1859 if you have a question for this morning's Bible line. Our next question comes in via live dictation from George out of Connecticut, and he writes, some pastors say that Saul was the first king of Israel, but Judges chapter 8, verses 22 through 23, and Samuel chapter 12, verse 12, say that God was really the first king of Israel. I would like to know what Dr. Brogy thinks about this.
Well, God, in one sense, was the first king, and that's totally accurate. Remember, Moses, when he writes his last book, the book of Moses is a general term that refers to all five books. But Moses, by the way, is credited with authorship of all five books in one form or another, either Old Testament writers quoting him directly or the New Testament. And so the JEPD theory is sheer and utter nonsense that originated in Germany in the 19th century. But with that said, the fifth book is written by Moses, and Moses gives instructions for a king. Well, wait a minute. I thought God was their king. In fact, when they go to select Saul, we're reminded through the prophet Samuel that God said, I wanted to be your king. But the people looked around, they saw the surrounding nations, they had a king, and they wanted a king like the surrounding nations. So it is true. It was a theocracy. It was run by God directly. And again, going back to the first question in Reformed theology, because they believe that Israel has been replaced with the church, that the church is the new Israel, a question that came in last week about from Galatians 6, and it actually affirms that the church has not replaced Israel, just the opposite of what they use it for. But nonetheless, Calvin thought that the church was the new Israel, and so he tried to run Geneva like a theocracy. And so what did God do when you had someone who is a blasphemous heretic? They were stoned to death. What did Calvin do? Well, he burned Michael Servetus at the stake for bad theology. We're not in a theocracy anymore. We don't stone people who commit adultery. We're in a different age where God is no longer personally orchestrating over a nation. And so God alone wanted to be their king, but when the surrounding folks saw the nations around them, they wanted a king. And that's why prophetically Moses is really giving instructions, because he knows where this is all going. Just like he knows when in Deuteronomy he prophesies, and I cover this in my series on God's prophetic program, how the Jewish people will be scattered to the four corners of the earth across the planet. That never happened in Old Testament history. Now, there was a time when they were taken away to Babylon. There was a time when Assyria overthrew Babylon and more were taken to Assyria, but they were never in the truest sense scattered to the four corners of the world across the planet. And so it never happened in the Old Testament, but Jesus prophesies in Luke's gospel, 22nd chapter, that it will happen in conjunction with Rome conquering Israel. And indeed, it did happen. And it started in 70 AD and went all the way through the Emperor Hadrian, where the Jews were scattered across the planet. And so Moses predicts that. He writes about it before it ever happens. And not only does he write about that, he writes about the fact that in the latter times, they'll be brought back into the land from across the planet. And again, the Reformed theologian spiritualizes all these things, and he has to abuse the Scripture and apply a different principle for interpreting the Scripture. So Moses, in advance, is giving instructions on how a king should live, that he should, you know, take care of his own heart, he should study the Scriptures. Why? Because he knows where the nation is going. So in the truest sense, you're right, God was their first king, but their first human king was Saul. Good question. Let's go to the next.
Our next question comes from Erica out of Naples, Florida, and she writes, is a person who got a divorce and was remarried considered living in sin? My question comes from the fact that the Bible says if a woman gets a divorce and remarries, she commits adultery, as well as the person who marries her commits adultery. What are your thoughts on this, please?
Are they in sin? Well, it all depends. When you read, for instance, Mark's gospel, he said, whoever divorces his wife and marries another woman commits adultery against her. And if she herself divorces her husband and marries another man, the other man might never have been married, she is committing adultery. Why? Because in God's economy, the only rightful way in which to break the marriage covenant is through death. So, by the way, in Mark's account, Mark 10, that I just read, Mark 10, I read verses 9 and 10. There is no exception clause there. In Luke 16, and let me just turn over there very fast, Luke 16 and in verse 18, he says, everyone who divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery. Pretty straightforward. And he who marries one who is divorced from a husband commits adultery. So again, it's another example that only death can break the marriage covenant. That's what Paul taught in Romans 7. I've preached a sermon not long ago in Romans 7. It was just a side note, but I would say that God never uses an illustration with error in it to teach truth. And so he's teaching the believer's relationship to the law. And to do so, he illustrates with what God reveals about marriage. For the married woman is bound by law to her husband while he is living. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law concerning the husband. So then, if while her husband is living, she is joined, or some translations render it married, I think the NAS 2020 went that way, to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she is free from the law, so she is not an adulteress, though she is joined to another man. Again, pretty straightforward. Only death can break the marriage bond. In 1 Corinthians 7, Paul says to the married, I give instructions, not I, but the Lord. This is in deference to what he'll say a few verses later when he'll say to the rest, I say not the Lord, meaning on this first issue, this is something Jesus spoke to, and I'm going to tell you what he said. On the second issue, if you're married to an unbeliever, Jesus didn't address this specifically, but I'm going to tell you what I think, and with the same authority, because he's an apostle commissioned by God to disseminate truth. To the married, verse 10 of 1 Corinthians 7, I give instructions, not I, but the Lord, that the wife should not leave her husband. But if she does leave, and so God gives an allowance for leaving, not for remarriage, but for leaving. You know, maybe a wife is being beaten up black and blue. She should protect herself. She should leave. Maybe the husband is physically hurting the children. She should leave. Wisdom would dictate that based on letting Scripture interpret Scripture. Now, some say, well, he verbally abuses me. I don't think that's a reason for leaving. Nonetheless, to the married I give instructions, not I but the Lord, that the wife should not leave her husband. But if she does leave, what are her options? Here it is. She must remain unmarried or else be reconciled to her husband. And if the shoe's on the other foot, and that the husband should not divorce his wife. Where did Jesus say this? By virtue of what he said in Mark 10, 9 and 10, Luke 16, 18, that only death can separate or break the marriage covenant. Now, there is an exception, obviously, in Matthew 19. It's also first given in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5. Let me go to the fuller rendition in Matthew 19. And by the way, Matthew 19 is identical to Mark chapter 10. The Pharisees come testing Jesus. Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any cause at all? And, of course, the point of debate between two rabbinical schools in the first century, the school of Hillel and the school of Shammai, was over a verse in 24:1 of Deuteronomy, if a man found some indecency, saying his wife. And so what did that indecency mean? Well, one rabbinical school, Hillel said, you can make it mean whatever you want. You don't like the sound of her voice. You don't like her mother. You don't like the way she cooks. I mean, anything you want. And the school of Shammai, more conservatively, said, well, some kind of sexual impropriety where she's been unfaithful. And so they're basically saying these split Pharisees, which side are you on? And he answered, and he said, rather than find an exception, he says, haven't you read that he who created them made from the beginning them male and female? For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Don't you understand that? He takes them back to God's original intention in Genesis. They are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined, let no man separate. Or some of your English Bibles say, let no man divorce. Why? Because man has no authority over the marriage covenant. God does. Some judge may give you some certificate of divorce and says it's good. You're free. And God holds his certificate of divorce in heaven and says, this judge has nothing to do with it. When a man wants to get married, he doesn't look for a judge typically. Very often, I know it's changing in America and we're becoming more like Western Europe. We go to a preacher. We go to the church. Why? Because we know God has something to do with it. But when we want a divorce, we don't come back to the church. We go find some judge. And so, well, they ask, well, why did Moses give her a certificate of divorce and send her away? Because of the hardness of your heart. Moses permitted. He didn't command. They ask, why did Moses command? He didn't command. He permitted because of your hardness of heart. And there's a difference. Moses allowed it. Why? Because these were Old Covenant saints. And under the Old Covenant, people had a hardness of heart that in this age we don't know. Their heart of stone would become like a heart of flesh, Ezekiel says. And Jeremiah underscores the same truth. And so he said, but from the beginning it has not been this way. And then here's the exception. I say to you, whoever divorces his wife. Let me read it without the exception first. I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for immorality or fornication, the Greek word is porneia, and marries another woman commits adultery. That's with the exception. I say to you, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery, but with the exception, except for porneia. Now, what it does not say is this. It does not say, I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for adultery and marries another woman commits adultery. No, he has two distinct thoughts in mind. That's why there's two distinct Greek words here. I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for porneia, immorality, fornication, depending on which translation of the Bible you're reading, and marries another, commits moikeia. He uses two distinct words because he has two distinct views in mind. Why does he give this exception? And by the way, Matthew earlier speaks of what comes out of the heart of man, and he says fornications and adulteries. Is he repeating himself? No, it's the same two words, porneia, but in the plural, moikeia, except in the plural. He has different things in view. Why does Matthew include the exception? Because he's writing to a Jewish audience that practiced betrothal. And so there are four examples in the Old Testament where two people are betrothed and they're called husband and wife. There's one example in the New Testament. Joseph is called the husband of Mary. He's betrothed to her. It's unlike engagement in that it's much stronger. You went through a whole formal method to get betrothed. And if during the betrothal period a partner had been unfaithful, then the marriage covenant or contract, we might say, was not fulfilled, and so you could put her away. And so Joseph, being a righteous man, wanting to obey God's truth, is going to put Mary away. He's going to divorce her. Why? Because she's pregnant. And then, of course, God appears to him and says, look, what happened is not through another man. It's supernatural. This is a virgin conception, and he believes God, and he keeps her a virgin until, because the Bible doesn't teach the perpetual virginity of Mary like the Roman Church and Orthodox Church teaches, until she gave birth to Jesus. Then he had normal relations with her. And so that's why there is an exception. And by the way, for nearly 1,600 years of church history, that's how the exception clause was understood. Erasmus, who is a Roman Catholic theologian, introduced the idea that adultery after the marriage relationship allowed the innocent party and the innocent party only to remarry. And so marriage is a picture of Christ's relationship to the church. A man would go to the prospective bride. He would agree on a purchase price. They would drink from a cup. They would seal it. He would leave and go prepare a place for his bride. Jews typically got married at night. They would begin to send signals. She didn't know the exact day or hour, but she knew, oh, it's going to be this week. They were ready each night. And then the shofar blows. He comes with his groomsmen, and he takes the bride, and they consume the wedding. Consume the marriage. And so Christ agrees with the Father, the purchase price of the church. He seals that with the drinking at the Last Supper with a cup. He has left. He's gone to prepare a place for us. He's coming back for us and to take us to the Father's house. And so just as Christ's relationship with the church is unbroken, you can't lose salvation, so the marriage is supposed to illustrate this unbroken love. So what do you do? Probably half the people listening to me are on second marriages. You deal with it in a realistic way. You don't make excuses, my ex was this, my ex was that, or no, you just say, Lord, your word is clear. Marriage is one man, one woman until death separates us, period. What I did, and some of people listening to me were divorced against their will, and I get that. And you've remarried, and you remarried in ignorance, and you didn't know what God's word really taught. Well, you can't unscramble eggs, but you can ask for forgiveness, and you don't have to make excuses for what you've done. Otherwise, you're feeding other couples to potentially get a divorce because they look at you and they say, well, he or she is on a second, maybe even a third marriage, and it's really worked out great now. Maybe that's what I need to do. I need to trade in my wife for a new model, you know? This is just the evil of our day, and marriage has become cheap, and they're thrown away marriages. In fact, what I do with young married couples for premarital counseling, the very first appointment I have deals with the permanency of marriage that is to be unbroken. So are they in sin? Depends. Depends whether you've dealt with it. Now, if you're a Christian, all of our sins are forgiven, past, present, and future. So the bigger question is, are you in fellowship with the Lord? And you can hinder that fellowship if you rationalize what you did. And so you need to deal with it honestly. You need to deal with it honestly for the sake of your children so that they don't repeat a generational sin. Good question. We could spend a lot more time on that, but I hope that helps. You might want to listen to my message on Malachi 2:16, the last book of the Bible I preach, where God says through the prophet, I, the God of Israel, hate divorce. Next question.
Oh, we got time for one more, Pastor Carl. Comes from Faye via live dictation. She writes, in Romans chapter 1, Paul describes the the depravity of men and how God gave them over. Many people have asked me how it is that non-believers do not see that we are living in those days as Romans 1 highlights. Does 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 explain why?
Well, certainly, 1 Corinthians 2:14 says a natural man does not understand the things of the Spirit of God. They are foolishness to him. He can't understand them because they're spiritually appraised. And so a person who naturally comes into this world physically alive, spiritually dead, and by the way, that's how Paul describes certain unbelieving women. He said they're dead yet while they're living. Jude 19 speaks of those who are merely natural and literally devoid of the Spirit. They do not have the Holy Spirit living in them. They're physically alive, spiritually dead. So their capability to understand spiritual truth apart from the Spirit's grace to open their eyes is very, very limited. And so, yeah, they don't know what's going on. They're blind to the circumstances around us. And so we live in a day where, you know, people are calling good evil and evil good. They're substituting light for darkness and bitter for sweetness. That's our day, and this is the day that God prophesied would happen at the end of time. And people are more and more darkened in their understanding. And so that's Romans 1. Romans 1 could be fulfilled in an individual or a people in the first century. It's being fulfilled in America. It speaks of the wrath of God that is being revealed from heaven. Not that will be revealed, but is being revealed. There's different kinds of wrath. There's eschatological wrath, like in the time of the Great Tribulation. There's eternal wrath, like in the lake of fire. There's abiding wrath. If you're an unbeliever, the wrath of God abides upon you. There's cataclysmic wrath, like with Noah and Lot and Sodom and Gomorrah. And there's the wrath that is being revealed. And so in America, we basically formally, though in the 1920s in the Scopes trial, we said, well, legally, you don't have to teach a creation science. But it really didn't kick in until the 1960s. I remember I was in the fourth grade, and Miss Weeks says, I don't believe this, but I have to teach it by law. In our first grade class, they opened every day with the Lord's Prayer. That all changed. No God, no prayer, no Bible, no Ten Commandments on the wall, and we have to put policemen in the halls because of it. We said no to God, and God gave us over to sensuality. And so you had that whole movement in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. We didn't repent, so God gave us over stage two to homosexuality, which has now become a byword for even little children. And then the third stage is when God gives people over to an adikamos mind, a depraved mind. The alpha prefix refers to something that has been tested and it has been found wanting. So dokimos is when you take a metal and you heated it up and you remove the purity. And it was pure gold or pure silver. Adikimos, the alpha prefix, means it's not pure. And so man has a not pure mind. The Russian Bible says an upside down mind. That's where people are at today. And then he goes through this long list. But what's interesting is this is not happening just in America. It is happening across the planet. And therein lies the difference. And with Israel back in the land, contrary to the Reformed theologian, God is setting the stage for the return of his son. And if you don't see that, you need to see it. Women's Life Wednesday. My daughter-in-law, Kessid, spoke last week. My daughter, Grace Anna Castleberry, is speaking this Wednesday. We invite you out at 10 a.m. Wednesday night, we'll continue on. We're looking at the five crowns of the believer. We've been talking about some of these eschatological issues. Five crowns that God will reward the saints of God with in heaven. One's called the crown of life. And then if you're listening and you're looking for a church home, this coming Sunday night, September the 29th at 5:30 p.m., we have what we call a meet the pastor. It's not just a meet and greet. You come in and write down the questions you have, answer a few for me so I can get to know you, and I share our core values and attempt to answer your questions as you're either trying to find Christ, and if you're not sure you're going to heaven, get that settled. Come Sunday night, 5:30 p.m., meeting lasts about an hour. We have a place for your children. Or if you're a believer and looking for a church home, you can come as well. Well, we're out of time. I hope this has been helpful to you today as you walk with Jesus Christ.